am Mr. Taru. In this video, we're going to take a look at ratio and proportions. Now, this is basically just setting up a fraction that allows us to compare two numbers. A ratio is a comparison of two quantities by division. In other words, it is a form of writing a fraction. We can write ratios in this traditional fraction format. We can write it with a colon, which we see a lot of times in the back of household cleaning bottles. Maybe you have some kind of concentrate that you want to mix at different levels of strength to do certain types of jobs. You see colons like this written when they talk about gambling games and giving you the odds of winning and such like that. Or if you remember from algebra, hopefully earlier in this year or the previous year if you're doing geometry, that the word 2 meant division when you were taking word problems and writing them into algebraic expressions. That the word 2 is another way algebraic or in our language to describe division. And let's of course not forget that you can't divide by 0. We're going to work through 4 or 5 examples in this video to show you how ratios can help you solve real world problems. You might think of percents. You might have learned to start working with percents as part over whole equals percent over 100, and we did cross multiplication to solve those proportion problems. It helps us take measurements off of a blueprint and apply them to real life measurements. Maybe if you're taking a blueprint and using it to build a house, something like that. Let's take a look at our examples and see what they come out to be. We have a Porsche Cayman S has a length of 172.1 inches. Well, unfortunately, I can't afford that actual car, so I have a 1/18 scale model of one. How long is that model going to be? Well, there's many ways to set up ratios, and we're going to get into that as we go through the video and in the next upcoming videos. But what am I comparing, in this problem? Well, we have a scale, and our scale is going to be, let's see here. How about for our scale? Now, for the scale, I'm talking about this 1 to 18. That's the scale. That tells you how the model relates to the actual item. And we have, we have 1 to 18. And again, this colon is our 2, our division. And so when I see a 1 and an 18, what measurement of, I'm asking for length. So what measurement of length is for the model? It's certainly the 1. It's not the 18. That's a bigger number. So that's going to be the actual length of the car, not the length of the model. So we have a model length over the actual car length. And that scale that we've been given is 1 to 18. Well, so we have information given us from the scale, and then we have some actual measurements that we're going to use in conjunction with the scale. And one actual measurement that we have is 172.1 inches, and that's the actual length of the car. So if we decided, and this kind of dictates how we're going to do that, if we decided that the length of the model is going to be over the actual length of the car, and we have a fraction set up based on the scale, then now we need to take this 172.1 and decide, is it going to be in the numerator or the denominator? Well, the numerator with the 1 over here is the length of the model, only length because that's specifically what the question is being asked for, and that's what measurement we're given. So the 172.1 is going to go in the denominator of our ratio because I've determined that's how I want to set this problem up right from the get-go. Model length over actual car length. The scale again says 1 to 18th, and we're going to do, find the length of the model based on the length of the actual car. Well, when you have an equation with one fraction on one side and one fraction on the other, you can solve that equation by doing something called cross multiplication. Now, you can't do this unless it's specifically, again, you have one fraction on the left and one fraction on the right. If I had two fractions on the right-hand side, then I would either need, I'd have to do two things. I'd either have to find common denominators and bring those two fractions together, or multiply something through the entire equation to cancel out all the denominators, or just deal with them as I go through the problem. But I have one fraction on the left, I have one fraction on the right, and that means that we can draw a cross, basically through this problem, a big, sort of like an X actually, and follow the pattern of that X to show us how to do the cross multiplication. We have 18 times X Okay, and as you go through this cross, you are multiplying, so 18 times x. In the middle of this equation, we have an equal sign, and we have to maintain that. A lot of students like to kind of forget it and set up a fraction right at the end, but that can lead you to the incorrect answer like half the time. So we have an equal sign in the middle, and then we have 1 times 172.1. Okay, well, now that I've got my fraction from the scale and my fraction from the actual measurement, and I've done my cross multiplication, I have 18x equals 172.1. We're going to undo that multiplication of 18 to solve for x, and then ultimately get, you know, right at the top of my head, an actual length of 9.56 inches. Or I'm just going to round it off to 9.6. So, based on the fact of this scale that's on the box, based on the fact that you know, we've looked up some information on the internet and found the actual length of the car, then if the scale on the box is correct and everything's been made from the toy manufacturer properly, that car, that toy model of the car should be 9.6 inches, that model that's sitting on my shelf. Okay, that is one example of how to do a ratio or proportion problem. Let's get to the next one. The quadrilateral has a perimeter of 216 centimeters, and the sides have a ratio of 2 to 5 to 4 to 7. How long is each side? Now, a quadrilateral, let's not forget, is a four-sided figure, and, you know, I could just kind of just draw any four-sided figure right there that kind of looks like a trapezoid, but don't pay attention to that. And let's not forget that perimeter means that we're going to take all the sides of this polygon and add them up. We're going to pick a vertice and we're going to go along all the sides of that quadrilateral, and we're going to add all those up and make sure that the perimeter is equal to 216 centimeters. Well, when I say the sides have a ratio of 2 to 5 to 4 to 7, this is certainly not drawn to scale, but maybe I'll put a 2 here and a 4 and a 5, and a 7. You know, me telling you that the ratio is 2 to 5 to 4 to 7 does not mean that that is the length of each side of this quadrilateral. Indeed, if you add this, 2 and 5 is 7, 7 and 7 make 14, and 14 and 4 make 18. These four sides add up to, well, not a length of 216 centimeters. So what this means is that the lengths of these sides are variable, but they stay in that ratio of 2 to 5 to 4 to 7. Now, a couple of things here. You're seeing that when we talk about this idea of ratios and word problems, we don't have to be limited to, you know, that idea where a fraction only has one numerator and one denominator. I can look at all four of these sides together, relate them all four together at once, and then have that perimeter of 216. So we don't have that strict numerator and denominator idea. If you do set that up, of course, you can't divide by zero. You know, I can't have any one of these sides, you know, be zero, because then I wouldn't have a quadrilateral. Maybe if that side was zero, I'd only have a, you know, a triangle. At any rate, just like in a fraction, you can reduce a fraction. Like if I say that we have 12 over 16, well, both of these numbers are divisible by 4, and I can, you know, do that division of 4 and say that 12 over 16 reduces to 3/4. Well, that's what's happening here. This is sort of like a reduced, simplified version of the sides of this quadrilateral, but ultimately they have to add up to 216. So I'm showing this multiplication of x on each one of those sides, saying that they can get bigger or smaller, but they have to get bigger or smaller by the same multiple to keep that constant ratio. Just like we have 12 to 16, I've basically either, you know, you could say divided each of those numbers by 4 or multiplied each of these numbers by 1/4 and get a fraction. Excuse me. Sorry for the interruption. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to remember that to find perimeter, we want to add all those sides up, and that's exactly what we're going to do, but remember that we don't know the actual lengths, that they vary, but they have this ratio. So we have 2x plus 5x plus 4x plus 7x is equal to 216. So we've got our four sides, we've added them up, we've made it equal to 216 because that's what we're told the perimeter is equal to. And we're going to solve this for x. Well, that means that we're going to have to add all those like terms. So we have 2 and 5 make 7, 7 and 7 is 14, and 4 is 18. So we have 18x is equal to 216. We're going to divide both sides by 18 and find out that x is equal to, let's see here, there's 118 and 21. 21 minus 18 is 3. And so we have left 36, and 36 divided by 18 is equal to 2. So x is equal to 12. Now, that allows us to solve for x, and we're done if that's what the question asks for. But I specifically said how long is each side. So I need to take this value of x, plug it back into each one of these expressions, and find out that my first side is 2x, or excuse me, I know what x is now. It's 2 times 12 is equal to 24. We have 5 times 12, which is equal to 60. I guess I'll work my way up. We have 4 times x, which is equal to 48. And we have 7 times x. 7 times 10 is 70, and another 14 is 84. So there's the length of my four sides, and if you want to make sure that these are correct, of course, you want to make sure that they add up to the perimeter that we were given to, which was 216. I've got, I got some more notes and some more examples. Let's get to them. Properties of exponents, assuming that A, B, and C, and D, none of those are equal to zero. I want to show you how much flexibility that you have when setting up proportions and still have that possibility of getting the exactly correct answer. Well, we have our initial given ratio here. We have A to B is equal to C to D. And when you have these equal ratios set up as fractions, then when you go from the lower left-hand corner to the upper right-hand corner, these two numbers are called the means. In upcoming sections, I'm not going to focus too much on the vocab right now, but in the upcoming section, we're going to be talking about, or sections of notes, we're going to be talking about geometric means, and that's where they're placed in these equal ratios. And then as you go from the upper left-hand corner to the lower right-hand corner, these values are considered the extremes of your two equal ratios. Now, how can I rewrite this and still be able to get the same value, the same equal relationship between these proportions? Well, I can take both sides of the equation and I can simply flip it or find or use the reciprocals of both sides of the equation. Now, again, it's important to remember that these properties of proportions only works, as you can see with these examples, where there's one fraction on the left and one fraction on the right. So if you had, 2 over 3 is equal to 1 over 2 plus x over 7 or something like that, where you had one fraction on the left and two fractions on the right, if you were to do any of these properties, but specifically if you were to try to flip both sides of that equation, you would be skipping that process of finding common denominators, and it would definitely throw you off, throw your work off and give you the wrong answer. But with one fraction on each side, you can take the reciprocal of both sides of the equation, and if you were doing, say, like cross multiplication, you would still get the same value for whatever variable you're looking for. You can, let's see here, we originally started with A over B equals C over D, and you can see in this third example here, the third setup, I've taken my mean values and I've flipped them. So instead of A over B equals C over D, these means have been flipped, and yet this would still give us an equivalent answer. These ratios are still equal, and if we were looking for just one of these values, we'd still get the same answer after doing cross multiplication and solving for the problem. And also, you can add the denominator to the numerator of each of the ratios so that if A over B is equal to C over D, then I can take these denominators and add them to the numerators and say A plus B over B is equal to C plus D over D. Okay, so there's four ways to set up these ratios that would still give us all the complete answer. So what I have here, though I haven't really, introduced the idea of similar figures to you yet, that'll be coming up in the next section, I have two triangles basically nested inside of each other, and I have it set up so that, given to you that x over 5, that this little small segment of length over the 5 is equal to y over 8. So x over 5 is equal to y over 8. Now, given that that's true, we'll explain a bit more why when we get into similar figures here coming up, or specifically similar triangles. How can I rewrite this ratio and still get an equation that is valid, or that I have two ratios which are equal and, you know, equal to this original setup? Well, I've taken the x over 5 and written it as 5 over x, so I have written the reciprocal of the first side of, or the left side of my equation. So if I take y over 8 and flip it and have the answer of 8 over y, then these two equations are equivalent, or that, you know, these two are equal, and they give the same value, they have the same relationship. I interrupted there for a second, sorry for that. So here we have x over y equals. Well, if we look back at the original ratio that we're given, I have x over y, and here I have x over 5. But as I go from lower left-hand corner to the upper right-hand corner, we can see that the y was one of my mean values here that I have labeled, and the y's been dropped down. So basically, to come up with this ratio, I'm taking the 5 and the y, I'm taking the two means, and I'm swapping places. X over y is equal to, okay, the y's come down, so the 5's going to come up, and we have 5 over 8. Now, I like to just sort of like look at the diagrams to kind of figure out what's going on with these numbers and why does this still work. We have x over y equals 5 over 8. We're saying that this is working. This is valid. That's because in the first ratio, we have just a portion of the large triangle set up to be over just the bottom portion. And we're kind of going in the same direction. We're kind of going from top to bottom and saying that x over y is equal to 5 over 8. You see how it's like part over part, whole length of this small length, the whole length of this small length, and it's going in the same direction. That's why this works. If you go back to this one, we have x over 5, so we're going from right to left on the top of this diagram, part over a whole length, equals y over 8, part over a whole length of that small triangle. Again, right to left for both of these ratios, and we have that same pattern here that we can see in this diagram. The last property here says we can add the denominator to the numerator of each of the ratios. So if I have x over 5, I can take that denominator and add it to the numerator and have it as x plus 5. So, you know, seeing that these properties, I can say, well, x plus 5, that 5 was my original denominator, so this must be x plus 5 over 5. And if I've taken my first fraction and I've added the denominator to the numerator, then I need to do the same to the second fraction, or the right-hand side of the equation. So where I had a y, I'm going to take that denominator and add it to the top and get y plus 8 over 8. So all four of these versions are valid proportions for this diagram. Now, other than just saying you can take these denominators and add them to the numerators and just, you know, say it always works and that's because, let's go back to our original diagram again. And what pattern is going on? Well, the x plus 5 is the entire length of this large triangle here, the outside triangle. X plus 5 is that entire length, and it's being placed over the corresponding entire length of the smaller triangle that we have inside. It's actually called a nested triangle. So the entire length of x plus 5 for the big triangle over its corresponding side for the smaller one of just 5. That's what we have here. When we look at the y plus 8 over 8, well, again, well, what do we see here? Y plus 8 is the entire length of the large triangle, the bottom length, if you will, over just 8, which is the entire length of the small triangle. So we have large triangle, the entire length of its side, over the corresponding entire length of the small triangle, equals the entire length of the large triangle over the entire length of the small. So again, we have this, you can see that we have the same pattern for both of these fractions, large triangle, small triangle, all four of these parts being the entire lengths of both of those triangles. Again, as opposed to what we have over here, just the small portion of the large triangle over the entire length of the small one, and again going right to left, over y over 8, small portion, the corresponding small side of that large triangle, or part of the just that large length of the triangle over 8, which is the entire length of that small triangle. So as you look through all four of these and you look back at that original drawing, you're going to see the same pattern in both of those fractions that are on each side of those ratios. That's really what I focus on with geometry, is showing that like pattern that's in each of those fractions. You're going to see a lot more of that as we do our similar triangles coming up. Maybe a little bit over-explaining for this video, but I think it's important. For any of these, if x is equal to 2, solve for y. Now I can pick any of these ratios to do this last example, but just to give you some more algebra review, I'm going to pick the most complicated one that's down here at the bottom. Again, I'm actually picking what probably is the most amount of work, but I want to give you guys as much algebra review as possible. So I want to say, okay, you can't solve, you know, one equation with two unknowns, but I'm giving you one of the two. I'm saying that x is equal to 2. So we have 2 plus 5 over 5 is equal to y plus 8 over 8. Well, just to save some room here, 2 plus 5 is of course equal to 7. And we're going to, you know, solve this equal proportion with cross multiplication. One fraction left, one fraction on the right. So if you have a choice, most students are more comfortable with the variables on the left-hand side of the equation. So I'm going to start with the part of this cross multiplication pattern. I'm going to start with the part that has the variable in it. And so we're going to have 5 times. And here's specifically why I picked this most complicated ratio to do this example with. I have a lot of students that incorrectly, when they have a binomial, on the top of one of these problems, they will do the 5 times y, but forget to carry it to the 8. So when you have a binomial in one of your fractions where you're going to do cross multiplication, as you do this cross multiplication, make sure that you wrap that binomial up in parentheses so that you remember to actually distribute that 5 that's in this denominator to each of the terms which is in that numerator. And then we have 7 times 8, which is 56. So we have 5 times y is 5y, plus 5 times 8, which is 40, equals 56. We're going to subtract both sides by 40. To undo that addition, we have 5y is equal to 16 divided by 5. And y is equal to what? Well, I don't want the decimal out of your calculator. 5 times 3 is 15. Okay, so it's 3 and something. Well, 3 times 5 is 15. 15 out of 16 leaves with a remainder of 1. So we have 3 and 1 fifth. And that is what y is going to be equal to if x is equal to 2. Now again, we could have picked any of these four fractions, these four equal ratios, to solve this problem. We would have gotten the same answer. I picked this version simply because I wanted to remind you about that distributive step that you need to do when solving that kind of problem. I know I'm talking a lot, but I hope the explanation is helping. I got one more example before this video is done. Last example. We've got three ratios all set up to be equal to each other. So basically we have an equation with three equal signs. Basically what I have here is a fancy way of writing two equations together, because my three ratios together have two unknowns, x and y. And when you have just one equation, you can't solve for two variables usually at the same time. So what we're going to do to solve this, to find, you know, some value of x and y that makes all of these ratios equal to each other, is pull this apart and really just make up two smaller equations. We're going to take a look at the first two, which, as you notice, if I take the first two together, they only have values of x. So we have 5 over x minus 4 is equal to 10 over x. We're going to cross multiply. Now, in this particular problem, we have x's on both sides of our equal ratios. So I'm going to have a variable on both sides of my equation, so there's really not one way to start that's better than the other. Let's do 5 times x is 5x, and that's equal to 10 times x minus 4. You might be able to do that distributive property in your head. I like to show the work as I teach. So we're going to take that 10 and distribute it, and we get 5x is equal to 10x minus 40. We're going to, we can't solve for a variable when it's on both sides of the equation, so I'm going to subtract both sides by 10x. And I get negative 5x is equal to negative 40. We're going to divide both sides by negative 5. Trying to undo this multiplication of negative 5. And get x is equal to 8. Okay. Let's get to the next part of this problem. Now, I don't have a geometric shape in this. I actually kind of paused because I intended on saying, you know, is this, you know, a possible number? Is it valid? Because we can have negative measurements in geometry, like negative angle measurements or negative lengths. But I didn't give you a geometry figure to start this problem off. So, yeah, anyway. So, we've taken the first two parts of this sort of very complex compound equal ratio type setup, and we found that x is equal to 8. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take the last two and set those equal to each other. And you see we're using the 10 over x again, both in the first equation and in the second equation. So that common fraction, that common part of my equation here is going to connect all these together and hopefully give us a correct answer and keep all three of these related. So we have 10 over x is equal to 3x over y. Well, of course, you know, I can't solve for an equation with two unknowns, which is actually part of the reason why I started with the left two fractions here, because I needed to know what x is equal to. So we have 10 over 8 equals 3 times 8 over y. So we have 10 over 8 is equal to 24 over y. We're going to cross multiply. We're going to do that by that right there. So we have 10y is equal to, let's see here, 8 times 20 is 160. We have 8 times 4, which is 32. So 160 and 32 is equal to 192. Divide both sides by 10 to get rid of that multiplication of 10, and we get y is equal to 19.2. And that's the end of my example. Now, if you want to make sure that your work is right, of course, you might want to take these values and plug them back into the original equation and make sure that you don't end up, you know, like say, dividing by 0 because you can't divide by 0. That's not going to happen because x is equal to 8, and neither one of these is going to come out to be 0. Y is equal to 19.2. I'm going to step out and write the check up here just to make sure it's right and finish this video. Well, we were given three ratios that we needed to be kept equal. We found our values of X and Y, and we checked it out, and I got the same ratio or the same decimal value of each of those ratios of 1.25 each individual time. That means my answers are right, and that means I'm done. I'm Mr. True. Bang! Go do your homework.